steps that were created, that were done. This is level 9 of 10, where the hips and legs and then the shoulders, neck, and head were created. And this is, I said, level 9. Well, we can go up to level 10, which shows all those steps being performed in a single image. So just to give you a sense of what the interactiveness of this is, so here is our custom visualization of the sequence. So you can choose whatever camera angle you want, but then you can view the playback of the edits at 10 or 11, depending on which index you're using, levels of detail. At the lowest level, you see every single action that's performed. So you see every camera change, every move of vertex, and so on. You can play this back quickly. So this is exactly the same thing as a time lapse. But you can also go up level of detail and see a whole bunch of changes at once in just a single shot. Now, I said you can choose which camera you're viewing, but you can also see it from the point of view of the artist if you wanted to see exactly how they were working. And you can step through, choose, you know, from an extremely high level view or get a little more details. Down across the bottom are just a couple of snapshots at different points in the timeline, and you can scroll through, seeing which, you know, this is the same thing as like a video player, the little scroll bar of the video player. Let's see, what else do we have here? So another really cool feature is being able to filter down the timeline to certain operations. So here we're gonna see just the extrude operator, so where the extrude was used. And you can filter down to any type of operation. But probably more interesting is being able to select or highlight part of the mesh, and then you can filter the timeline down to the edits that only affect this part right here. So here we'll see the arm is selected. So right along here are the points, the highlighted areas down the timeline are where the arm was being operated on, some sort of edit was happening there. So we could just get a view of what happened to the hand or the arm, and so on. Okay. Just as one other example, here is a hydrant that was constructed, and then I'll show how the end cap right here was constructed in 9 steps. So in the top left, we have a cylinder was added, and then there's a series of loop cuts and insets and so on that eventually came to the final cap here. So all these visual annotations, again, were done in the visualization system completely automatically. All the artists had to do was just record themselves at work. Okay, so before I move on to the next part, are there any questions? I'm just kind of rushing through some stuff. I can probably take like 1 or 2 questions.
Quickly, the operators for extrude and the annotation is, do you have to, how does the system work with, if you have like relaxing vertices or bridging, you have many operations, how does that get annotated?
Sure. So in our system here, we just stuck to very basic operations, extrude, move, and so on. But you could potentially extend this on to handle more sophisticated types of tools or and again, this was also focused on polygonal modeling, so this is not at all sculpting. Sculpting has an entirely different workflow. But we do have, and I'll mention this a little bit later, but we did extend this paper to, this technique to include sculpting as well. Okay. All right. If there are any questions, I'd be happy to answer. You have one question?
Do you include modifiers?
This is just operations that are performed on the mesh. And I'll remember your question. I'll be certain to answer it afterwards. So I want to move on just to make sure I don't run past my time. So the second paper that I would like to talk about is MeshKit. So this is diffing and merging meshes for polygonal modeling. This is a paper that was published at SIGGRAPH 2013. So if I showed you these two meshes, they're just two snapshots. You have no idea what happened between them. Can you tell me what happened in between those two edits? And you know, the artist, I'm certain, is in the room, so he could probably tell you. But there's a lot of gross changes. Gross isn't like really obvious. Some new geometries being added. There's some features across the top, but there are also some very small, fine features that could be very easily missed if you were just visually inspecting this, there's an edge loop that was actually existing in the previous, in the shoulder ball here, that was removed in this, that would be very easy to miss with visual inspection. Here's another example where the mesh on the right does not at first seem like it might be a derivative, but it actually is a derivative of the mesh you see on the left. And then here we have two really heavy meshes with lots of geometry where there's many different places where there's changes that happen, but finding every single one can be rather challenging. So we tackled this problem by taking a very similar approach to text diff, where we defined a cost metric in text, in the text world. Every change, an addition, deletion, or change is one unit of cost. Here we define the cost to be matching elements of one mesh to the elements of the other. So how much does it cost to match this face to this face and this vertex to this vertex? And it keeps in mind the neighborhood as well. So we define this cost metric, and then we developed an algorithm for basically going through and doing the assignment, doing the matching between these. Again, details I'm going to hand wave for now. If you want some details, you can talk to me afterwards. But let me show you some of the results. So here are two different versions of the Syntel's head, where this was early on in the process where they were trying to figure out what shape her face is going to look like. And so I'm going to use this as a demonstration. So the first step in our algorithm goes through and finds any vertex that hasn't moved much, matches them up, and does the same thing with the faces, which in this case, there are considerable changes that happen, so vertices that move quite a bit. So there's only a few that get matched up initially. But then we use that information and propagate this out. So we basically grow these patches out based on this algorithm and the cost metric, and this continues to go around the entire face, and eventually we have a pretty good matching, but there's some issues with the ear. The ear are actually very similar to one another, but the way that our algorithm moves forward, it can hit a local minima, if that makes any sense to you. So we have a backtracking step to remove those elements, and then we recontinue on until we get this mesh right here. So just to give you an idea of what you're looking at, the one on the left is what we consider the original. In this case, it doesn't really matter. Any face that does not have a match in the other one's colored red, so this could be considered a deletion. And in the derivative mesh you see on the right, we highlight unmatched faces in green, so this can be considered an addition. So you can see around the face, there is an edge loop that was added, and then right across the collarbone as well. And then the faces are colored in blue to indicate how far a vertex was moved. So the gray here was not moved very much when compared to its original position, but then this deep blue, as highly saturated blue, indicates lots of moving, so lots of sculpting and so on. So this is the general process, but it applies across many different meshes. So we went to Blend Swap, found a whole bunch of things. We pulled stuff from open source projects and used them. So here is the same creature mesh from before with all the changes highlighted. So you can see many of the features that were easily picked out are very obvious. But then you can see also the tongue had some sculpting done to it. It was moved around. There's lots of teeth that were added and so on. Here is the women from before as well. So you can see the dress actually matches up very well. It was sculpted to be more of a down dress instead, and then the front was added in, and obviously the hair was removed and so on. And then here is the shuttle example with all the additions and changes being highlighted. One other example is the Durano open source project. Yeah. So here's Pablo provided different snapshots of the mesh while he was working, and I took these meshes and just ran mesh git between each pair. So from the first to second, second to third, and so on. And I can highlight different things in the sequence to indicate when geometry was deleted, when it was added, when it was added and then deleted again. So across his tummy here, there was a little inset that was added in, some shaping done on the hips. Okay, but not only can we do diffs, we can also do three-way, not only can we do two-way diffs between two meshes, we can also do three-way diffs. And we can turn these changes into actual operations and merge them potentially. So over on the left, what we're seeing here is a Shaolin monk that down the in the bottom on the center was the original mesh. And the one on the left here was sculpted to make him a little bit heavier. Okay. Then this original mesh was, so this is one edit. This is one derivative, derivative A. And then the second derivative took the original mesh, removed the skirt and boots, and added sandals and feet. Now these two operations, according to some details in the paper, are non-conflicting. So you can do the movements and you can do the deletions that they don't overlap. So we can actually take the edits that were done from the original to derivative A and the edits done from the original to derivative B and combine them automatically to create a new model that combines both sets of edits. But the cool thing about it is these are edits that are actually on the mesh, so it maintains all the original topology of the original edits. So we can apply subdivision surfaces on the merged mesh, and the results are what we expect. Okay, so I ran through a lot of stuff. I imagine there's lots of questions, but just to kind of summarize, mesh flow, we instrumented Blender to record the artists at work, and then we applied a clustering algorithm to summarize, and then we visually annotated the mesh sequence to show the edits being done, doing that fully automatically. And then in MeshKit, we took snapshots to find a metric of change and an algorithm to determine what edits happens. We didn't actually have the edits that happened between them. We just kind of made them up by our algorithm. And with this, we're able to visualize two-way, three-way diffs and do merging of edits. So I mentioned earlier that mesh flow only works on modeling. We extended this a little bit later to handle sculpting, which is kind of interesting. But all of this kind of went towards answering this one question of, okay, what if we had multiple people, multiple artists, independently working on the same thing? So you can think of the scenario of a student wanting to know how to model the spaceship. You have a set of students. How do you compare the different workflows of the students? So this is, we have some preliminary results. It's really pretty cool, but it's still ongoing. We'd like to get a lot more data. So if there are any modelers in here that would be interested in being part of some research, please come talk to me. Like I said, it's really pretty cool. And I think there's some really great educational tools that we can pull out of this research here. So I'd like to thank my research collaborators, a lot of artists, many of you are here. Thank you very much for your data. Acknowledge the funding. Here is my my contact information, and that is all. Thank you.
First question about the mesh flow. Is it related to Blender? Can it be used in any 3D application? And how does the artist do the snapshot? I mean, does he simply work and then he presses a button and that's the snapshot? How it works?
So it's related to Blender in that we actually instrumented Blender itself. We went into C code, and in the code path where basically it hijacks the undo. So every time the undo functionality happens, it will record what action was performed and then write out, save the blend.
So basically you save the undos to this?
So we save it to a sequence of files, yes. And that's essentially what this later project was doing as well. So we're just recording what happens in there. So your other question was, could this happen, could we apply this to other modeling programs? Sure. if you can get a nice clean action and a snapshot of the mesh out of the system, then it doesn't really matter if it's Blender or Maya or 3ds Max. That doesn't matter. As long as you can get, you know, like I said, a clean action and a clean snapshot. If you know how to do that in Maya, come talk to me. I had some trouble with that. So.
And about one more about the mesh Git. Mm-hmm. Is it like you simply save to two different blend files and then compare it in the mesh Git?
So you can think of this as in Git or SVN or some other repository. If you have a model and you check it out and you do some modifications, you check it in, and some other artists had done some modifications on that same file and tried to commit it. Well, in SVN it says, oh, you know, it's a binary file, it doesn't know how to merge the sets of edits. These are just snapshots of the model. It doesn't necessarily pertain to Blender. We were actually exporting them as POY files, but you can use any data file. We were just looking at the geometry. So any file that stores the geometric information.
Cool, yeah. Thanks.
Thank you for your talk.
Yeah.
I'm really amazed by the Meshflow system. It really reminds me of my beloved Lego with the construction manual.
It was kind of
the same. I was wondering, is there a way to like add the explanation from the artist to the thing, because you don't have the audio because it's not really a movie or a video. And I don't saw anything for text annotations or something. How does that work?
Sure.
Is there a possibility?
Well, our research was just, we didn't want to go down the path of actual tutorials because it's really challenging. So we wanted to tackle as simple of a problem as possible, which meant just record the artist, don't worry about any annotations. Because on top of that, you have, well, what if they go up in summary? Do you need to provide a new type of annotation for that? However, you could record the audio while the artist is working, so he could be speaking while he's working, just the same as a regular video tutorial, and then just have this as a supplementary addition to it, or play back the audio while you're playing back the video. So you can certainly extend this to handle all sorts of different annotations. We just didn't do that. Yes. Jonathan?
Do you record the time when the edit is finished so one can sync it with with the audio?
Yeah.
Great.
Yeah. I mean, we're saving out the file, so you can just look at the file when that happens. You can also look at, you know, that could be part of the log, the action log when you record stuff.
I mean with the understeps that you record.
Yes. Yeah.
Ah,
yeah,
cool.
You can record the times and then play back in actual artist.
Wonderful.
Well. Yeah.
How feasible would it be to take the mesh diffing, like where you showed with the monk, where you basically combine the two different edits into a new mesh? How feasible would it be to actually take a series of commits, say like you're building a hand, and each commit you add a different feature or a different change, and then actually generate a whole bunch of new models based on variations of those?
Sure. So one example I didn't show was we had a spaceship that had conflicting edits, and this is very similar to that, where we took one model and then we added a bunch of features, and then we took the original model, added a bunch of features, and they happened to overlap. And our diffing or our merging algorithm detects these conflicts and allows the user to decide how to resolve these conflicts, just like SVN or Git would do. Conceivably, you could do this. Conceptually, you could do the same thing with a sequence as well. So you can turn on and off edits. In fact, you can certainly turn on and off edits. Yeah.
Okay. So at first, I thought Jonathan was going to ask my question, but so my question would be, I think you kind of answered it already. Also regarding the diffing functionality, that this is not currently usable as a tool. So basically, if I actually were to commit my blend files into Git or SVN, it's not like I could use this as a diff tool for comparing blend files.
Well, Yeah, I don't have it. I haven't written the code to load a blend file.
Yeah.
But if you had that piece, then yes, you could do that.
Okay, so that's the only missing component.
Yes.
And also the merging.
We wrote a visualization system to do that, but you could conceivably do all this in Blender as well. So you can have some sort of connection with like SVN or Git. Git, you can configure it to where if there's a conflict of edits on a .blend file, then call this tool, and that could be in Blender or something else. So you can configure that. Yes.
Okay.
I don't know if it's the same as Jonathan's. If I saw the spaceship, and my idea was, if there are multiple non-conflicting changes, but to generate a whole bunch of variations depending on the non-conflicting changes. So I could model 5 different variations, and then I have 24. I don't know the math. So.
Yes. Yeah. So all those features, the algorithm goes and groups them together to try to granularize the edits. So it's not just, well, there are changes that happen here and changes that happen here, so I can't merge them. But it actually groups them together into patches. And then you can turn on and off these patches. And it doesn't matter if they're overlapping. It could just be, here's a sequence, and I want to spatially undo a feature that I added in. So regardless of the time, as long as there aren't any edits that happen afterwards, you can undo spatial changes.
I really liked your first flow thing. Do you already provide it as an add-on? So can I use it for myself to instrument what I do? And what is the impact of the instrumenting? Do I notice it even, or is it just there for me?
On relatively small meshes, so fewer than, I don't know, maybe 20,000 faces, you don't notice it. It's like hitting Control S, essentially. So if you notice a pause when you actually save your file, then you'll notice a change in here. We just took a very naive, simple approach to how we instrumented it. So there may be, they're Blender devs, maybe we can optimize this a little bit, do it multi-thread or something. Presently, I do have the instrumentation patch available. It's for version 2.5, 2.54. It's an older version of Blender. I haven't updated the patch in a while. But you can download it and merge it in.
It's a C patch. I need to compile Blender.
Yes. Yeah, it's actually modifying the C code of Blender.
Can't you grab just the Python modifiers, the operators? Can't you just grab that?
Potentially, yes.
Add-on?
Yes.
Okay.
Just another question about the merging and conflict handling. Because I'm a developer, so I usually have a tool like KDiff3, which in a conflict offers me, do you want a line of file A, or do you want a line from file B, or do you want both from A and B? Would you be able to offer such a solution?
Sure. Does that make sense on a mesh, though?
Yeah, that's what I'm wondering.
That's my question. Like, from an artistic point of view, does that actually make sense? So we took the very conservative approach and said, well, you can either choose neither, you can choose A, you can choose B, or we'll give you all the data and you can merge it by hand. So that was our approach. Because we don't know what it means to merge geometry where it's actually intersecting, because that seems to conflict with the artist's original intention.
Well, I can imagine in the example that you gave where you pick an upper guy and remove in one edit and remove his shoes in the other.
Yeah.
That it does make sense to fasten up his shoes or something. I don't know if it would be possible to do something like that.
Sure. We also considered conflicting edits not to be in a spatial sense. So removing the boots, if he actually had feet underneath it, which in this model he didn't, but removing the boots is is just an operation on the boots. It's not on the actual character itself. But we do consider if the if they overlap on the same mesh, like the same
vertices and faces.
So yeah, there are lots of different variations you can go down this way. We took the extremely conservative approach just to say, here's what we can do.
Is there a good documentation on how to set up Meshflow and record something and then turn it into a video with these pretty arrows for something like me who hasn't used it at all?
There's very limited documentation. It was just for the reviewers to say, here's how you do it. Beyond that, no. I'm guilty of the documentation not getting written, but if somebody is really interested, I could sit down and write up, you know, here's step by step how to do that sort of thing. So.
Cool.
Okay. All right. If you have any more questions or details, come and see me afterwards. I think the next talk has already started, so I'd like to end.